All right, thank you, everybody. We're going to call to order now the Lynn Zoning Board of Appeals, December 3rd, 7:10 p.m. We can have a roll call for the members, please.
Member Payas?
Present.
Member Massey? Member Peter?
Yeah.
Member Crowitz?
Here.
Member Lopez Hernandez?
Present.
Member Olson?
Present.
Member Maggio?
Present.
All right. We're getting started with the cases. Last meeting's minutes. Did everybody take a look at the meeting minutes? Are there any edits or changes? Motion to accept.
Second.
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Move and start with the cases that we have tonight. We'll be starting with case number 1009025 Ames Street.
Can you get rid of the other ones first?
The ones?
Get rid of the ones that can leave.
Which ones are?
So you got Hanson Street.
Hanson Street.
That's no, if anyone's here for Hanson Street.
Is anyone here for Hanson Street?
Anybody here?
Yes.
No?
Okay. So that one's done.
Yeah.
And then the one on Neptune Street, 123 South Street.
That's all.
Continued. Well, continued.
Are they here?
Sam's here. They're just going to continue.
Another case.
But
okay. Anybody here for Neptune Street, 5 Neptune? All right.
So we just take it to the end of the meeting.
Yeah.
And what about Linden Street?
Anyone here for Linden Street?
41. All right. Linden? We'll take a.
I'm sorry. Let's just do that one real fast because it's a withdrawal.
Real sorry. So case number 10072, 41 Linden Street. Can we read the description, please?
Yeah. 41 Linden Street, Lynn, Massachusetts, parcel numbers 020-285045. To vary the provisions of the City of Lynn zone ordinance to allow the construction of a three-family house in the R4 district. The property has 5,096 square feet of land, 15,000 feet is required, and it appears that the property lacks sufficient left, right, and rear setbacks and required parking. The variance request requires the Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that only these circumstances relating to the soil conditions, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land or structures, but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it is located.
All right.
I'm sorry. A little enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and that desirable relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public good and without nullifying or substantially derogating from the intent or purpose of such ordinance.
All right. We can have the petitioner come in. Name and address, please.
Michael Davis, 506 Columbus Avenue, 1 Boston, Mass. 02118. My plan was to resubmit plans based on some of the feedback that I heard, and I just found out today at around 3 o'clock that I was on tonight's roster, so I'm here tonight in hopes of withdrawing without prejudice and then resubmitting plans once we have something that might be a good fit for the city.
Okay, we have here some communications email detailing that.
Yeah. Hello, Mary. It's been some time since I last wrote or left a voicemail. I hope all is well. Attorney Sam Vitale just called to let my business partner Jack Rosa know that 41 Linden Street is on tonight's agenda at the ZBA. Until an hour ago, I was unaware of this plan. My apologies for this request being made at the last minute, but considering that I do not yet have new plans to submit to the board, it seems as though it is best for my proposal for a house to be submitted at a future meeting, but not tonight. I'm interested in moving this process forward until I can come to the Zoning Board of Appeals with an updated set of plans. I would like to ask to withdraw my proposal without prejudice. I would return to City Hall in early 2025 in order to submit a new application proposal. As always, please let me know if you have any suggestions. I am available by email and phone. Thank you very much for your continued assistance. with my plan for building my new home.
Thank you. So the formal petition to withdraw without prejudice, just as a quick FYI on this and the process is that, as the intention is, if the withdrawal goes through, refiling at the timeframe that you had mentioned, the only thing that the petitioners usually have to comply with is overseeing again the advertisement fee.
Yes, very good. Thank you.
So do we have a motion in relation to this case?
To the withdrawal without prejudice?
I second.
Second.
And to give them just to pay the advertising fees. Let me see if it's on the screen. Member Lopez Hernandez?
Yes, to withdraw without prejudice.
Member Maggio?
Yes, to withdraw without prejudice.
Member Paez?
Yes, to withdraw without prejudice.
Member Krawitz?
Yes, to withdraw without prejudice.
And Member Olson?
Yes, to withdraw without prejudice.
All right, that's all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Now you can go.
Sorry.
So now we will proceed again the original line. So we'll start with case number 10090. We can have the reading, please.
Is that Ames?
Yep.
Okay. Twenty-five Ames Street, Lynn, Massachusetts, parcel number 02031-4017. An appeal, an order of the Chief of the Department of Inspectional Services that a foster care of cats is permitted in the R2 General Residence District. An appeal to the permit granting authority as the zoning ordinance or bylaw may provide may be taken by any person aggrieved by reason of his inability to obtain a permit or enforcement action from any administrative officer under the provisions of this chapter by the regional planning agency in whose area of the city or town is situated, or by any person including an officer or board of the city or town, or of any abutting of an abutting city or town aggrieved by an order or decision of the inspector of buildings or other administrative official in violation of any provisions of this chapter or any ordinance or bylaw adopted thereunder. To vary the provisions of the city of Lynn zoning to allow a single family home in the R3 General Residence District to be utilized as a cat shelter, which is a use not permitted in the district. The variance request requires the Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that such that owing to circumstances relating to the soil conditions, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land or structures, but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it is located, a little enforcement of the provisions or the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and that desired relief may be granted without substantial detriment to his public good and without nullifying or substantially derogating from the intent or purpose of such ordinance. We also have two letters that I'll read that have an effect on this case. Regarding 25 Ames Street, dear Vice Chairman Lopez Hernandez, as you are aware, I am the duly elected ward, 7 city councilor for the city of Lynn and also serve as a council president. I have met with legal counsel for the petitioner regarding the petition and expressed my concerns. I believe that reasonable stipulations must be placed on this petition if the zoning board of appeals approves said petition. Having spoken to the law department and inspectional services, I have several suggested recommendations if this petition is approved. We require the petitioner to comply with 330 CMR 30.00 Animal Rescue and Shelter Organizations regulations. No animal waste may be disposed of in the City of Lynn trash collection program that must be collected in accordance with generally industrial methods. There shall be a reasonable limit to the number of cats housed at the property at any one time. The petitioner shall be subject to periodic unannounced inspections by inspectors from the Department of Inspectional Services. Thank you for your consideration in this matter. Very truly yours, John M. Walsh, Jr. And then we have another letter. Which I am not going to read all the attachments to the letter, but I will read the letter. Reference is made to the application to Lynn Zoning Board of Appeals of Carol Polstrom relative to the above property, which is 25 Ames Street. The purpose of this letter is to call to the attention of your honorable members a complaint received recently in the Inspection Services Department. The complaint, as is their right, filed such complaint anonymously. The crux of the complaint is that at times, especially in warmer weather, there is a strong odor and flies from 25 Ames Street. Further, that the odor and flies are a nuisance to the surrounding homes, making it such that at least one neighbor is not wanting to use their exterior deck and yard. There is a further complaint that food is being left in the yard of 25 Ames, and this attracts raccoon and other wildlife. Lastly, that trash barrels are frequent, full, overflowing with cat waste and other waste from this property. Attach your notes from the inspections conducted on July 12th, July 17th, and December 2nd of 2024 that support the veracity of these complaints.
I think that's all the communications for reading. We can start opening with the petition.
Thank you. My name is Martha Coakley. I'm of counsel at Foley Hall Ag, and with me is my client, Carol Polstrom, who is the owner of 25 Ames Street. I just want to clarify a couple things at the beginning, because an Officer Poole is here. He's been very professional, easy to work with on this, and I hope he will weigh in if he has something to add to this. But as to the latest thing you just read, I just found out about that yesterday. It is anonymous, which I understand is the right of the complainant, but I want to give you a little bit of background, because prior to that complaint, and I'll speak to why this is before you in some regard, there were no complaints from neighbors, abutters that we are aware of, but for the one that you just read, which is new. I can't rebut it because I don't know who it is, and it's about the summertime. It's not current. And so I wish you would hold that for now. The other issue is that the finding of the Officer Poole and the board was that upon reflection and our discussion about it, because I was there on July 17th when we had the inspection that he looked at, he has termed it a foster care. It's not an animal shelter. We recognize that in this state and in the city of Lynn, an animal shelter is probably not a permitted use. This is an interim foster care that my understanding is it's not permitted, but it's not permitted, and I'll get to that in a minute. But what I'm really asking you to consider is whether this activity is within what's permitted in the city of Lynn, in a single residential home, and that you overturn the decision by the building inspector. And my client, of course, as we've discussed with Officer Poole, and this matter, by the way, is really more one of Department of Health and Sanitation, it seems to me, if you have a complaint about smells or flies or whatever you have. And I will note that at the date that Officer Poole came, July 17th, there was a sanitation health inspector who came. The two issues she had, and I didn't submit the reports because I didn't know that this was going to be an issue tonight until this latest report came in. The issues were there were some smoke detectors that needed batteries, and there appeared to be some wires that might have been live in the back. We took care of that within 2 days. Batteries were installed. The wires were not live, and there was no official or other complaint by the sanitation department. Having said that, we are perfectly happy to work with sanitation in the city of Lynn. Let me get to the thrust of this, if I may. And a little bit of background is important to know why we are here tonight. So the Carol Polstrom owns this property. It was devised to her by a will and trust executed by the prior owner, Elaine Brosclair, who died in March of 2023. She and Miss Polistrone had worked together both with Elaine's cats that lived in the house and with what are either feral stray cats, and they trap them, they neuter them, and if they're adoptable, they then give them to an animal shelter like MSPCA or the Northeast Animal Shelter. She does not adopt out cats. She does not have traffic at this house. The cats that are there for a period of time, relatively short, you will see that last week we had lots of supporters for her. Tonight there are three animal control officers here from Winthrop, from Saugus, from Everett. The officers feel very strongly about the work that she is doing, that works also with the Lynn Animal Control Officer to make sure that these cats are properly taken care of, they're dealt with in an appropriate way, and frankly save the city of Lynn and some of the surrounding communities a lot of expense, and make the cats that are socialized available for adoption. Just as an aside, apparently with the number of animals that we now get in Massachusetts from the south, both dogs and cats, there's a lot less room in the animal shelters themselves for local cats. And so Carol and others who do the work that she does pick up that slack, and you're welcome to ask, and I'm sure the animal control officers can speak to the importance of what she does and why there have been no complaints. People support it. You've seen the petitions that were signed. There was an online petition that she didn't even start that had over 100 signatures in support of her work. What I want to point out, though, is because I understand that when the will was announced and Carol was both given through the will and a trust, the home and the responsibility for taking care of the deceased cats and the other cats that they did, as I've just described, there were objections filed in the Essex Probate Court by the sister of Elaine Bosclair and the surviving nephew of her other sister who was deceased, Adele Doney, who lived in Lynn. This was a long and somewhat arduous fight in the Essex Probate Court. It ended last week when the objectors withdrew all of their objections with prejudice from that. So the owner of the home now is Carol Polistrone. And I would add that the complaints that led Officer Poole to come to the property in the first place were filed inaccurately. I would argue, well, I won't say that. They were inaccurate and they were untrue. They were filed by the spouse of one of the objectors saying that she lived in that home, that it was an animal shelter, that there were smells and it was inappropriate, which is why Officer Poole came and why he did a very thorough inspection. You got his reports. You also have in my paper submitted the letter that he submitted indicating that he felt it was more of a foster care situation than a shelter care, than a shelter situation. And so we have worked with the sanitation department. We understand that the city council president, and I spoke with him, it's in his district. I understand his concern. I don't think he has personal knowledge of the home or what was going on, and I know he's looking for some protections. We don't oppose most of those as long as they're reasonable. But I think that the work that Carol does in benefiting Lynn, and really other than this anonymous complaint, and if the complainer is here tonight, so be it, but they'll have an opportunity to be heard. But otherwise, that to me is an issue that we can deal with, particularly as the Senate, not the Senate president, wrong body, I'm sorry, your city council president acknowledged that he wants to make sure that there's no problems in the neighborhood.
That is essentially what I wanted to say today. I think that you as a zoning board can find that this behavior, this activity, is a permitted use in Lynn, that you can dismiss the findings of the building inspector. You can put, if you want, concerns that we will work with sanitation and the health department on. If you're not willing to do that, we could consider a variance, but I don't think you need to get to a variance, frankly. We're willing to do whatever you all think is appropriate to do it. I know this is different probably from most of the cases that you have, and certainly probably from most of the cases here tonight. We don't have building plans. We're not putting on a porch. We're not trying to do anything. What
my client is trying to do is the work that she cares about and loves. And again, I point to three animal control officers who were here last week, who were here this week, and many of the supporters of the work she does. She is a good neighbor. She wants to continue to be a good neighbor, and we will do whatever we need to make sure that there are no complaints or concerns in the neighborhood that might be concerns, again, for sanitation or for health as opposed to the building department. So I will stop there. I'm happy to answer questions or see if people have concerns or questions about this.
Before I open it up for members, just a quick opportunity for anybody of the city staff before member starts with questions. Any preamble information? All right, then opening it up to the members. Any questions?
Carol, I understand you own the property. Do you live there?
No, I'm there most of the time.
You're there during the day, but you don't live there at night.
Well, I'm there some nights too.
Where do you really live?
Where
do you live? Where is the address?
My address now is in Everett.
I just know she's a little hard of hearing, so.
But I spend most of the time.
So, okay. So you live in Everett and you own this house because your mother lived here too. Okay.
It's not her mother. It was devised to her by Elaine Bosclair. That's okay.
I just assumed it was her mother.
No, it was a good friend and a colleague that she worked with doing this work for years.
I know that you stated that you disagree with a lot of the complaints that were made. But my question is, do you disagree with any of the facts as presented by Officer Poole in his report?
If you look at both of his reports, and I spoke with him about a couple of them relating to the MSPCA, I think he corrected those. I don't disagree with the facts. I disagree with his conclusion that it was an animal shelter. But otherwise, no, he was conscientious. He was careful. He has been easy to work with as we've gone through this process. And so I have no complaints about his fact finding.
And all his observations of the way it was is not contested, correct?
Other than the conclusion, it really isn't.
Okay.
I have several questions, but more on what are you proposing to do here? How many cats? How is it going to be staffed? How is the facility going to be sanitized regularly, according to the state regulations? How is disposal of waste going to be handled? Is there incineration? Storage of waste has to be indoors, it can't be outdoors. Odor control, that type of stuff.
And have the cats outside.
And how many cats are we talking? Because usually the staff, you're going to have a certain amount of staff per hour's work to do those.
This is not an organization necessarily. There is no staff. It is Carol and people who volunteer with her. What happens here and the ways in which cats come to her by and large are when there is a fire. There is a hoarding situation. There is a situation in Lynn or surrounding communities where they get Carol and others to take these cats, to spay them, neuter them, and then see if they can be adopted. None of them, these are transient cats. So maybe they're there for 2 to 4 days a week, but there's never more than, I'd say, 40. And occasionally there have been larger numbers with kittens because they don't want to separate the mother from the kitten. But that's when the MSPCA will come and take them, or the Northeast Animal Shelter.
I understand. Once you're exceed 15, it's considered cat boarding unless you're in the shelter.
I'm not aware of that, sir. Where's that definition from?
So that, we got a CMR on how to handle. I'm concerned with the public health of this.
Understood.
The eventual paperwork and the reports that I saw before. But I want to know, how is this place going to be managed? If you bring in, how do you quarantine an animal that's sick? What is the quarantine? What is the procedures? There doesn't seem to be any formal process to this, and I would feel comfortable that this thing is going to be run correctly going forward. But that's what I want to know. What is the plan for operating this facility? Do people show up here, they capture a dog at 2 a.m, they come into the neighborhood and drop it off? What are all the processes to understand what, I don't want to be living next door to this facility in this order. And if I lived there, I'd be I would have been complaining a long time ago. And so I have issues coming before us without a formal plan on how you're going to operate this facility and keep public health at the forefront. How are you going to handle waste? How many cats, how many people are going to be managing that? The rooms have to be cleaned daily. Twice, you know, every other week, you're going to have to disinfect the entire rooms. Do they have the right flooring to clean it? The walls, are they going to be contaminated? How the kitty litter is, it's airborne. That couldn't cause disease. You know, interaction between animals outside and all of that. I don't hear any plans on what you're actually proposing to do.
Well, it's not only that. Yeah, I just want to say, Victor, it's not only that. It's that, and I'm going to preface this by saying, I really appreciate what you're doing. I also rescue animals, but I rescue the number of animals that I can handle. So I rescue animals, and they're kept in my home, and they're kept safe. But I don't have 30 or 40 cats. I would never do that to my neighbors. So my big concern is we represent the people of the city of Lynn. You're from Everett. You talked about Saugus and other places that have come with their experts that have said how wonderful the work she's doing is. That's wonderful. Do it in Everett. Do it in your heart.
And she does as well, and Chelsea and other communities.
The most.
And yeah. The Lynn.
It's a problem.
For yes.
Yeah,
yes,
it's a problem.
To Kevin Fatsworth.
So I will note that there, for a long time, was an ACO in Lynn with whom Carol worked. He retired, my understanding is, in the last year or two. The new officer is new. I understand why he doesn't have the history with her and what she's done at the property. And because it's a hearing before the zoning board, I appreciate that he wouldn't necessarily be here. I don't think you can read anything negative into that. But this is, and perhaps you would take 2 minutes to hear from one of the animal control officers about what she does. But the fact is that Elaine Bosquer and she have been doing this protocol procedure since 2017, almost 8-10 years. It is not a project. It is not anything that any of her neighbors have ever complained about before. She is at the end of a dead-end street in a single-family house that's well-maintained. If you want to go back and look at Officer Poole's report, he noted no rats. Good thing, right? He understood, and the Lynn Sanitation folks had given her an extra barrel for that when he was there. He noted in his report that there were problems with pickup anyway in the summer with Lynn, but there were no reports that I'm aware of, and I've asked, and they had notice to come last week or to come this week, any complaints about the neighborhood. I appreciate what your concern is. I understand your job, as is the president of the city council, to make sure that neighbors and neighborhoods aren't adversely affected. But if they had been, or they were, we would know that. And this is not, again, a shelter. It is a project, a hobby, a passion that she pursues. And she uses her house, which she owns, with the prior owner and now hers, to do this work over a period of time that isn't adversely affecting anybody else, including the house is clean. I've been to visit it. I went to see it myself. Officer Poole was there. He appreciates that, you know, his only complaint was that he thought there were too many cats. I get that. But the problem with too many cats is that, you know, they're not outside. They're kept in kennels. They're clean. Their kitty litter is changed. And the house itself is, I think Officer Poole would tell you, is in much better shape than many homes in Lynn that he visits. And maybe I'm talking a little bit off script on that. But the house itself and the activity that she does, you wouldn't even know about if someone who wanted that house in the probate court hadn't complained that she lived there and that it was an illegal animal shelter. It was untrue and accurate. And I will say this now, it was malicious. This has been a very nasty will contest over who's going to get that house. And all of those objections have been withdrawn. And the folks who made the complaints that brought Officer Poole there had a malintent, I would argue. And so I would ask you all to keep an open mind. And as I said, we will work with you, with the sanitation board, with any of the neighbors, to make sure that any of the concerns that you have are taken care of appropriately.
So when I think of a foster care, I think of something 15 cats or less is foster. When you start getting in the realm of 40 cats, you know, that to me is getting into shelter. And you're bringing cats from outside the area that need to be quarantined before they get mixed with the other cats, for the health of the cats, but also for the neighbors and how things are going. So I haven't heard what you're going to do, you know, for that many cats. I think it needs to meet the intent of the safety regulations associated with the regulations.
And can you refer me to...
How do you refer? So if you go into 310...
And these are state regulations you're referring to?
30. So 330 CMR 30, Animal Rescue and Shelter Organizations regulations. There's specific items in there for how you regulate, you know, manage your waste. How you deal with sanitation, how you staff the place.
For an animal shelter.
Right.
This is not an animal shelter.
But it's not a foster home once you've got 40 cats.
But they're not, it's not like there are 40 cats.
No, there should never be 40. And, you know, so there should, to me, I don't think there should.
You want to address that, Carol?
If you have 50, I don't have an issue with that.
Can I give you an example?
I want to see your actual plan.
On the Lynn Commons, that big building, I don't know the name of it, but I got a call from an animal control officer. They took a woman out by ambulance. They needed help to get her 5 cats out of the apartment. So he called me. So I went out there and I said, just stay in the hall. Let me go in and take a look because the cats get scared. Cat. So I opened the door, I went in, and I seen one run underneath the kitchen sink. So I says, oh, okay. I looked under the sink, and there was about 15 of them all huddled together under the sink. I said, you said 5? Well, there's at least 15 under the sink, and I haven't even gone into any of the other rooms yet. This was on the 10th floor. So I go into one of the other rooms. There was a piece of cardboard up against the wall. And I looked, long story short, there was 28 cats that had to be taken out of that apartment that minute, okay? I got 28 cats out of there and had people come and meet me to come and get the cats for me so that we could make sure that they were safe. It's not like you walk in there and there's 50 cats running. It's nothing like that. This is getting all blown out of proportion. It's a temporary safe haven. They could be there for 10 minutes. They could be there for a day, 2 days. It all depends, but it's not this crazy smelly cat house. It's a temporary safe haven because there's no place to bring them.
Yeah, so if you're going to do this, then you need to come up with a full plan on how you're going to manage this site.
I've been coming for 20 years.
That's not a plan. There's people that come in front of us that have businesses.
It's not a business.
But it's not a business. How they're going to operate the business.
It's not
a business. It has to be drawn out to show us that you're going to operate it properly. I don't know who you are. I don't, you know, from what I've seen so far, you know, it's a single family house in a residential neighborhood. And you want to put a shelter or whatever you call it. I don't know what it is without the plan.
Would you be willing to hear from one of the animal control officers?
I've never seen what the plan is. You've got nothing in front of us.
Okay, then I would need...
I can't vote for something, but I don't know what...
No, I understand. And I...
Just a quick clarification. Yes. I know that you mentioned Project Passion Hobby. It's this Project Passion Hobby in reference to... not through a series of state regulations because it's disputed on the nature of what is being identified that use in that space. Is there other types of best practices or guidelines that can be cited and can be presented on how that is supposed to run?
And if so, present them to me.
Well, if so, and
any time back and present that.
No, and we can do that. I understand that. But as long as we're here, I just want to be clear. I want to be clear on what your concerns are so that we address them. So I'd appreciate knowing that from everybody. I don't want to come back and have you say we didn't address this or that. So I need to know the concerns. And to address your question, which is a fair one, I have done some work in this area with other shelters. I work with the New England Assistance Dog Service. The state was on them because they said they were a shelter, which they're not. But there are very specific rules and regulations for animal shelters, obviously, to make sure that the animals are safe and that public safety is taken care of. There are none that I'm aware of for this foster care definition, but it is in the state regs that is not a shelter. And if you look at the CMR, there's a mention of foster care. They don't require a plan, but it says interim taking care of cats. They're not being hoarded. They're not being housed there for any period of time. It is essentially a way station for the animal control officers who have picked up cats, as I said, from hoarding situations or fires or other situations. They don't have any place to put them now. And that's what Carol does. That's what Elaine and Carol were doing since at least 2017. I am happy to draw out more about how it works, but the plan is what it's been for the last 8 or 9 years. And there have been none of the concerns that understandably why you have them. And I talked at length with the city council president, and he said, I have my constituents protect. I get that. I do understand that. And I want to make sure you are satisfied, if not tonight, then in the near future, with how we are going, what we do now and how we are going to go forward with it. But if you can tell me what your specific concerns are, it would be easier for me to address that. And if I may, I'd love for you to hear from at least one of the animal control officers who can describe how she works, how Carol works with not only them, but with the Lynn also animal control officer. Are you willing to do that?
We'll have an opportunity for other favors.
Fair enough. Okay.
Express
I have to say, even if you come to us with a plan, that is absolutely no guarantee that it's going to pass this board.
I didn't expect that, nor am I asking that.
Sure.
No, but in order for me to come up with a plan that's going to satisfy you, and then I need to know if you have other concerns, and whatever the opinion is, I'm going to need a certified copy of that. Because to me, this is an individual who owns a home in Lynn, is not bothering anybody, does a terrific public service, and I think you at least could be considering open to that idea, as long as the concerns that you have, that any city would have about sanitation, public health, we understand you would have those, and we will try to address those.
I think they have a single family house. How is it going to be converted, into a foster care facility?
It's not going to be converted. It's not going to be converted.
So what is the procedure? You take a cat and throw it in the living room?
No.
How would they help?
No.
Those are details that are, there's no details, right? If you have a cat that's sick and you bring it in, and you put it without the cats that help you. Now all the cats are sick.
It's not what happens.
So, they have quarantine requirements, but bringing in cats from outside the area into an area for health reasons. So how is that handled? What are the processes for that? And how are you going to manage the facility itself? Rather than we're just going to take a cat and have it.
And so,
I don't know what it is. You haven't told me anything.
Well, what I can suggest to you, because I didn't know this was going to be the issue, and I think that if you read Officer Poole's report, the conclusion is that it's a cat shelter, and cat shelters are not permitted in Lynn. If you come back and say it's not a cat shelter, okay, then we'll deal with what other issues you have. What I can do is describe what Carol does, what the procedures are now, what happens with cats who are sick. She knows they have to be quarantined. She has kennels inside that keep those cats separate, and they do not roam around and infect other cats. That has not happened.
It's becoming a game of semantics, what we call it, a cat shelter or not a cat shelter. I didn't want to become that. I know you're doing a wonderful thing to save animals. You're doing a wonderful thing to save animals. But our concern is, like I said, the homeowners in the city of Lynn that are surrounding your house. And you've had complaints. So what Victor says is appropriate. You need to come up with a plan to how you're going to deal with the complaints that have been made. And then we'll decide if that's adequate.
Sorry. Number
five. Sorry.
So I guess we're being asked to kind of draw a line somewhere as to what is acceptable. And I don't know that this board is really designed to do that. I guess what I would like to have happen is some type of process where we sort of outline what the operation looks like. And say, this is sort of like, this is what's acceptable, because what happened and what was observed on in July in the inspection may be the high watermark of what the city deems to be acceptable, and everything in between may be absolutely fine. Or maybe even more. I don't know where that line is. It's not my job to draw it. But I at some point, you know, we're being asked tonight to grant the variance or determine that the previous report was incorrect. I guess, would you be entertain that type of a conversation? With the city, before we would say have to make a decision on saying this is something that we're going to allow in perpetuity, which is really what the variance would do.
Yeah, and I'm not even suggesting that a variance is needed, by the way. And I'm saying is that the ultimate conclusion Officer Poole came from, and he is here, by the way. So the ultimate conclusion was that it is foster care, which anybody in Lynn could do, right? And it's a personal thing that people can do. I get that you're concerned about the scope of this, so we will address that with you, how it works, what the proposal is that we do now, and how we deal with sick animals and look at numbers and all of that, so we can come back before you, understanding that it's not automatic that will be approved of. I just want to address something you said, though. The two complaints that brought Officer Poole there were brought by the spouse of the woman who was trying to take the house away from Carol, because they objected to the will, and she made up the complaints. She said, I live in that house, and I got them from a FOIA request. I got a public records. They were not legitimate complaints. And the one that you just read into the record just came in, and we don't know who it is. And I don't know if it's legitimate or not. And so, to me, it's a sanitation issue, but I did not.
It's just really hard to. How would you feel it? Yeah, and you do sit on the side of the table sometimes, right? If somebody comes in and says the complaints were false. I don't know if the complaints were false. Because you're telling me they were? I don't know if the complaints were false.
But can I just say, it's not so much the complaints, it's more the report that we're being asked to make a determination on. And what's in the report is why we're here. You know, so the origin of how it got to be may have been malicious and everything else, and I'll accept that. You say you got it from a FOIA request, that's fine. I have no issue with that. What I do think is the focus of the conversation is the state that it was in when a city inspector went into the premises. And that's really, I think, like I said, it's tough for us to say, you know, are you following state license standards? Is this a habitable, single family home? And all the, I totally agree with everything you said, that this is just as much a licensing and health issue as it would be anything else. And if you're under those, doing those things correctly, you know, the zoning issue, I think, goes away. But I don't know that that was what was observed in the report.
Okay, fair enough. Because the reason we're here is because he made an adverse decision, said it was a shelter, and said, I have to shut you down because it's not permitted, and your only recourse is to come before the zoning board, which is why we are here. But since he issued that and he stayed his order, he issued a second letter saying it is a foster care. And if you really read the report, it says there were a lot of cats in the house. We don't deny there were a lot of cats in the house. That's what happens. And I get the concern with numbers, but I'm trying to think about, you know, I have been on the other side of the table in many ways, and I know what your job is, and I respect it, and I'm trying to be respectful of that. But the zoning board is my only alternative at the moment. Yeah. And if you say, no, it's not, your only job is to say, is this a permitted use or not, it seems to me. And if it is permitted, then we will deal with everybody else. And then, and I know that you want to put some conditions on it, we'll consider that. But it's either permitted to be a foster, that an individual who owns a home can either foster cats or they can't. If what they're doing is causing a sanitation or health problem, there are other places in Lynn that will take care of that, or should take care of that, and we will deal with them as well.
Can I just ask the city a question? So are we operating under the assumption right now that this is a permissible use or not?
If there are no other questions about the concerns that have been already voiced, we can move them to other folks who would like to speak on it in favor of the petitioner, and we can also ask questions.
You need to come forward, please, and state your name and address.
One at a time, please. Name and address. Thank you.
Hi. I'm Officer Gobin. I'm a Gravoni from the Everett Police Department, and I actually help a lot of your Lynn animals and have been for the past 10 years. Lynn, as you know, doesn't have an animal shelter. You need 5 animal control officers at least. Myself, Winthrop, and saw this, we cover your city, just so you know. He needs help in your city. You need like 5 animal controls. So if you don't want us to bring a couple of our cats to Carroll, because we all have our own places. I have so many homes like Carroll's in my city, and I'm all for it. I know what a hoarder situation is, and Carroll's not one of them. I'm legally obligated to report Carroll if she's doing anything that steps outside the law, just so you know. And I don't mess around when it comes to animals or my job. Saugus and Winthrop will tell you we don't give her any of our cats. Her cats are mainly from Lynn, some Chelsea, because he's very sick right now, he's not around. And your own animal control officer has not had an issue. Justin, the prior ACO, did not have an issue with her. I worked 5 years with Justin. She would take guinea pigs in the middle of the night till I could come back and get from Lynn, by the way, to come back and get the guinea pigs in the morning. We would walk into hoarding houses, dogs, cats, ODs, deceased individuals with worms coming out of them and the dogs. I take the dogs, I'm like, Carol, I need your help. This is Lynn, this isn't my city. We are helping your city. So if you're gonna prohibit Carol from doing what she's doing, please build a shelter, please get more animal control officers, because we are helping all of your cats too. Your city, listen, I love Lynn, I'm from here. He's, you know, in the union, he's great. You need help, you guys need more help than us. My city's under control, not from what they thought. I've been there 10 years. Saugus is under control, Winthrop's under control, Livia's under control. You guys need help. So please hire more animal control officers. You won't need Carol, but it's a foster home. And as far as the regulations go, in my city, we give them kennel licenses. It's a basic kennel license. So in the city of Everett, if you were fostering dogs, what we do is, hey, you want to foster dogs? Apply for a kennel license. I go in and inspect. Inspectional services go in and inspect once a year. They're very cooperative. And we actually like them. They help us. In the middle of the night, if there's a fire and I'm not on duty, a dog can go to their house. It's mainly dogs, but we have one woman, she has 50 cats in a one family house, filtered water. It's just, I couldn't even believe she had 50 cats and she didn't want to tell me. And I went to her because I went to help her and she helped a dog. That's how I found the situation. It's not what you're thinking. You know, unfortunately, you know, she used the trash barrels. No one told her she couldn't use the trash barrels. It's very simple. In my city, I don't know if you want to speak to our animal inspector. We have these people down pat. It's a kennel license. It's regulated in my city. But the CMR, just so you know, that falls under shelter regulations. That's mainly the out-of-state animals coming in. That's more what the quarantine is. I'm very well rehearsed in this. I battle the state for 10 years, even when Martha Coakley was working for the state. She was unaware of all this at the time. those are very strict regulations on rescues. But if Carol was breeding, do you know you can breed whatever animal you want and you can do it whatever you want? There's no regulation. You can't grow. I have no authority yet. Well, and ever we regulate breeding now. We just put that law in. So if she was a breeder making money, she would literally be able to do whatever she wants and you guys would be up against a bigger thing. But because she's helping, that's why it is the way it is. And unfortunately, we know what's behind it. I've been through it. This wonderful person over here who takes some of your Lynn animals, because you don't have, your department tells them to leave them on the street. It's not even all over Facebook. They drop them off at my shelter in Peavey. My shelter's in Peavey, my dog shelter. You guys have an animal crisis in your city. If you don't want to have Carol, fine. Please hire multiple ACOs to help him out, because the guy in, and the new guy in Lynn for the last few years, he needs help. He calls Saudis. Can you help me? Can you hold this dog? Can you, what did I do with your cat? He's dropped cats off dying at her house. So if she was doing anything wrong, why were dying cats going to her house? Legally, me, I have to take them to, MSPCA doesn't help us. Animal Rescue League doesn't help us. My animals go to Blue Pearl. And guess what my job is? Euthanize it. I will never do that because I have Carol. I will not euthanize anything. There's no funding. There's nothing. Without good people like her, I can't do what I do. My animals would all be dead. And they should do a FOIA request on all the animals in Lynn, actually, to see what the outcome is. How many of them are dying? And there is a dog shelter in the city of Lynn, I believe. There's a kennel license for the woman who holds dogs, right?
I don't know. I'm unaware of that.
There's a kennel. Yeah, Believe Breeds Rescue. She holds dogs in her garage, in her house. So if she can do it, can you please let Carol do it? She's doing a good thing.
She give her our address so we can check it out.
Well, she's licensed. She holds me. She holds your Lynn City animals. She's paid by the city. So listen, I'm all for it. If she's helping your animal control, you guys just need a shelter. And you know, it's all collaborative, but as far as the 40 cats go, it's not what you're thinking. I would legally have to report her. They would not be leaving the animals. We don't actually give her that many, just so you know. And her neighbors, I just want to add this. Carol gives them food. I give them food. She helps their cats. She vaccinates their animals. She'll call me. Can you take in this, my neighbor's dog? They got a little puppy for their kids. Oh no, Carol, we can't keep it. We can't keep it. You take it. You take it. She's like, can you help this? She doesn't help dogs. Can you help this dog? So she's really well liked on the street, just so you know. But that's all I have to say. Listen, I like Lynn, but you guys really need help with your animals. And if you want her to stick to Lynn cats and have 15, fine. But in my city, it falls under kennel licensing. And if it's a basic kennel license, and I mean, we have kennel licenses for like 50 or 100, but it's not what you think. It just looks bad on paper, that's all. I understand I used to be a regular person. I thought it was crazy too, but it's really not.
Can she put her name? Can you put your name?
Sorry, I talk a little fast. Mm-hmm. I'm just very passionate.
Thank you.
My name is Darren McCullough. I'm the animal control officer in Saugus. I've been there about 5 years. I got introduced to Carol through Stacia. I'm also an animal inspector, so that means I inspect kennels on Route 1, the Red Dog. I inspect Goodfellas. I inspect PetSmart. I also inspect over 50 chicken coops, farms, horses, you name it. I inspect all of them. So my job is inspection. I'm an animal control expert, but most of us are also animal inspectors. When I go to Carol's, her biggest concern is, can you smell it? Does my house seem clean? Does it look good? That's her biggest concern. So when you're thinking cats are all over the house, right? When you go into Carol's and you bring her a cat,
no, that's good.
If it's a healthy cat or whatever, she quarantines her cats. Every cat is in a bin. You know, an enclosed area to themselves, unless it's a mother of kittens. And like she said, it's not about the amount of cats. It's a lot of times she's getting mothers with kittens, okay, that from a hoarding house or like, and believe it or not, there's a lot more of that than you realize. So when you go into Carol's, it's so organized. There's three floors. She's got everything. She's got one place for a quarantine, one place for these ones. These ones are being taken care of. It's amazing. If only the state would be as clean as she is, okay? I don't call the state because they don't return the call. I I use them, if I can, I utilize them, I will. I'll utilize whoever I can. I have my own shelter, okay? So if I get a cat, I can hold a cat, and I can say, Carol, I have a cat. Usually what happens is she gets that cat, she sends it over to a foster, or like one of the facilities you go to.
KBN.
Yeah, KBN Rescue, right? So I'll give her a cat. That same day, that cat's going to KBN Rescue. If it's an adoptable cat and it's been quarantined, I'll quarantine a cat before I give it to her, okay? And what she does is, it's amazing. And the state has utilized her for years. You got the power card, you went into her house, they used her for years, years and years. And that's the thing I don't understand, is that she doesn't have a license, and that's the number one. She's not a kennel, though. She's a foster. So when I'm dealing with rescues, like Melissa, who's a rescue, she can rescue, I take a dog in, and I'll hold that dog for the 10-day period. Then, in order to find that dog a home, I'll give it to Melissa or whatever foster through Sweet Paws Rescue. I can give it to, right? So I'll give it to those rescues. They have people that foster those dogs until they have space at their kennel, and they can put them in. It's no different, but like you said, is there a limit? I don't know. I mean, she's so professional, and she's been doing it her whole life. There's been no complaints up to this point. The only complaint was when the individuals that wanted the house and tried taking it from her. She was right. That house was given to her by the woman that lived there, that worked with her, that she cared for years before she passed. She didn't speak to the family. Okay, she didn't speak to any of the family, the woman that she gave to the house, okay? Carol does an amazing job. She's professional, and she has a system. Her system's been the most systems you'll ever see. And that's from the heart, because I've been doing this, and she's amazing, and that's, thank you. Thank you for your time.
Sure, can you write your name?
Okay, yeah,
Your name and address, please, and what department you're from.
Would you like to speak?
Okay. Hi, my name's Martin Sigley. I do animal control for the town of Marblehead, and I also manage the Marblehead Animal
Shelter. What department?
So I get the calls in for animals in need, mostly cats. Several Lynn residents do call. They have stray cats in their yard. They have mother cats that they're feeding. I tell them, call the Lynn ACO, and he's totally overworked. MSPCA Animal Rescue League. I tell them to call me back if they do not get a response. I get a call back, I'd say 9 times out of 10. At that point, I might go to Carol and say, Carol, can you go to Lynn? I'll give her the address, she'll pick the cat up. She gets them vetted at the pet clinic, our family vet in Peabody, and then we take the cat in. So they are all vetted, I think, within 3 days. So they are vaccinated, they're spayed and neutered, and then they go into the shelter. But I get the calls of the Lynn residents coming in. So that's all I have to say. Carol does an amazing job.
Thank you. Anybody else here to speak in favor? Petitioner?
In Winthrop, I'm the animal control officer. I've been there for 28 years. In Winthrop, if something came before any of the boards or whatever like this, I would have the board members go out to the property and walk the property and see what it's all about. I don't know if people have time. This is Lynn. It's busy. I've been to Lynn many a times at 2-3 o'clock in the morning when they're trying to get into a house with dead bodies or anything. Okay, I have already Lynn, Revere, Chelsea, we're all over. I think that you gotta look at how Carol does your business. It's clean, it's very good. If you go out there and take a look at the property, I'll tell you this is your job or whatever, maybe look at it and have a better understanding what the property is, how it's, you know, being used and everything. You might have a different outlook on it than just sitting here, not knowing, you know, what's going on. That's all.
Thank you.
Name department, I'm sitting.
Anybody else to speak?
My name is Claudia Georginas. I've been a volunteer at the Marlton Animal Shelter for about 23 years. So I know a lot about Carol. I'm on my 9th rescue from her, not all at once, over the 23 years. And I've learned a lot about cat care and respect for animals. And she does things right. And you would be losing someone very special and has such respect for animals, and you would lose a place to take animals and to get the help from. That's it.
Thank you. Anybody else to speak in favor?
I would like to speak. My name is Diane Katz. I'm actually a Lynn resident. I was born here. And I've been a volunteer for Bobblehead Animal Shelter for 30 years. And I just want to speak in terms of Carol's character. She's an amazing person. And I've cared for a fellow colony for 20 years. And it is painstaking work to go out there every night, take care of animals, go into the streets at all hours of the night, tied to go out there to make sure that the animals that are out there suffering in silence are rescued. And she does this day in, day out. And for a woman who Carol worked with to rescue these animals when everybody else just turns a blind eye, is amazing. And it speaks volumes about Carol's character that a woman would entrust her home and give Carol her home in order to carry on that work. So I ask you, please, please allow Carol to continue her rescue work, and she'll utilize that home the way it should be to continue the foster home and work with the various shelters that call upon her for assistance, and she will do all the animals justice as she's done for all of these years. So please give consideration to her.
Thank you. I think that is all right. Anybody else to speak in favor of the petition? All right, we will close that portion. Anybody to speak against the petition? All right, that's closed as well. What is the width of the board?
I heard a lot of people speak about her past experience with the owner, and they mentioned a lot of procedures they go through, operations they go through, bedding the animals, that type of stuff. So typically in front of a board, if you could outline what is your plan, how are the animals managed, how many are you going to manage at this particular property, how are you going to manage the waste? Obviously, you got 3 cats, so you got 40 cats, that waste management comes up with the same thing. I wouldn't want it stored outside, whether it's a shed outside, odor control, whatever it is, and it regularly gets picked up. Those are the types of things I would be concerned with. But I want to know, what is your proposal? And you haven't presented what that is. I don't know what you're doing other than you're taking the cats. If she's not around, what happens to this place and these cats? If she's not maintaining it, who else is it? So a more formal proposal in my mind to know what I'm voting on.
Yes.
Yeah, right, I don't know what that is.
Totally appreciate that. Could I make a suggestion? What if we could continue this, we will submit to you how things work now, suggestions for the issues that you've raised, including the public safety and sanitation, including we can consult with Lynn officials about that to make sure that we address that. I would ask that the board and Officer Poole allow the order to be stayed, any execution of that order while we do that. And given the time of year, if we could have 2 months to do that, and obviously if there are complaints in the meantime, we'll be sure to respond to them or deal with them. But if we could continue this for 2 months, we will submit before you what you've asked for. And hopefully, if I could get a copy of the city council president's letter, that would be helpful.
There are a number of offices from other communities. I don't know whether they can volunteer their help on how to do this. I think somebody mentioned an operator can help with some of the regulars.
Yes.
And there might be some ideas that you can garner from their expertise.
Yeah, absolutely.
And can I just say, the CMI that has been brought up, there is a section on it in foster care, and it envisions this being done in a residential setting. And I recognize that, and I do think that that would be a good way to guide the process forward, and sort of say, like, this is generally the guideline that we want to go.
Fair enough.
You know, I would really appreciate some type of a, not that I would, I don't want to vote on this. I don't want to have to say that the officer pool was incorrect in making that determination in his report, but I do think that there's a sort of a middle ground we could go down here and say these are the things. Maybe it is the city council president's request. Maybe there's some things that we could do. Maybe there's others we don't want to do. If you want to bring those questions to us, maybe. But a lot of this, I think, can get could get sort of squared away, sort of without us having to go down the track of approving a variance on this property, or making a determination that the officer's report was incorrect. So that's what I would encourage. If we were in compliance with the CMI, as it relates to foster care, I don't foresee any issues. But I would just like to see that.
No, fair enough. And I appreciate that. And I also, think that there is that way that we can move forward so that everybody's interests are protected, including, as I've said, the officer pool has been fabulous during this process. He's been fair. He's been communicative. He has an opinion that I happen to disagree with, but that's a different issue at the moment. But I think we know what you're looking for. Does everyone agree that we can continue this matter and continue enforcement of the order against Carol Polistrone for that period of time?
February.
Yeah, I'm looking at those dates there.
It's February 4th, okay.
On February 18th.
Yes.
That's a Tuesday night, right? You meet on Tuesday. So February 4th, let's do that. And when do you need the materials if we're going to do the 4th?
Filing date is January.
3 weeks before. So
to review in what time?
Okay, could we then do a little bit further in February, just because I want to be able to cover everything that you need and get 18th, it to you?
Is that
February 18th?
Yeah, that for the filing date.
School vacation week, it's okay for me. Is that for everybody else? Will you'll meet that week? Okay.
So it would be January 24th, the filing date.
January.
All the materials ready for the board.
File by the 24th. Fair enough. And do that. And just one of the reasons, it seems to me, is that taking that route rather than allowing a variance on the house is that this goes with Carol. She doesn't have a business or a porch that she wants if the house is ever deeded to somebody else. This would not go with the house if we take this route. So
yeah, and
it's her activity.
That was, I think, one of the concerns that I had.
No, fair enough.
It was going to be the next property owner was going to come in, and it might not be as someone as well trained in this. And so if we could do that, that would be great.
Fair enough. No, I appreciate that. And that is.
So we'll have to vote on that. Do we have a motion?
I'll make a motion to continue for 2 months and request inspectional services to stay enforcement of the matter.
Second the motion to February 18th.
All right. Can we have a roll call on this? Continuation.
So we're continuing to February 18th. Is that good for you?
Yes.
Okay. With 2025,
yes, and okay. With papers due 3 weeks before, as we did for this hearing. Got it.
Okay. Member Payers, to continue to January, to February 18th. Okay. Member Christopher,
yes.
To continue. Okay. Member Crowitz, to continue.
Yes, to continue.
Member Lopez Hernandez, to continue.
Yes, to continue.
And Member Olson, to continue.
Yes, to continue.
Okay.
Right. Well,
thank you very much for your consideration.
February.
All right. Happy holidays.
Martha, do you have the card? I'll give you my email. One more thing. Email. Let me have the email link. I got the card with me.
You gave it to me last time, but let me put it on this letter.
MGOKAS. MGOKAS @lynnma.gov. And you can send it directly to me and I'll give it to the board.
Fair enough. Just send that, it's lynn.ma.gov.
Yep.
Okay. And so I don't do the office approval then, right?
So, no, you do it. MGOKAS at lynnma.gov.
Yep. I'll tell you here and here. Lynnma.gov.
Lynnma.gov.
Okay. Correct. Let me give you my card. I have.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. I just said you wanted a fancy.
You wanted.
I remembered you had over that. Well, thank you so much. So I'll send you a quick email, okay?
All right. We're going to continue now with the rest of the cases. We're going to be reading case number 10081 77 Alley Street.
77 Alley Street, Massachusetts, parcels numbers 052744030. To vary the provisions of the City of Lynn Zone Ordinance to allow a contractor's yard in the WFI district with parking spaces with less than the required 5-foot setback from property and street lines. The variance request requires the Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that owing to circumstances relating to the soil condition, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land or structures but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it is located, a literal enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and that desirable relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public good, without nullifying or substantially derogating from the intent or purpose of such ordinance.
We got letters we've read like 100 times.
Okay. Nothing new in terms of communications on the case.
They're all read from before. You got one from.
We had a full public hearing. My name's Tom DeMarcus. I represent the petition Jerry Raffaelli. We had a full public hearing in September. And the board wanted, we're trying to put a contractor's yard in a waterfront district. We need a variance from this board. We needed a special permit from the city council. When I came in September, this board didn't want to act until I got the special permit, which I got in October. And then I came back here and there wasn't a quorum of people that had sat on the September hearing. And I came in November, there was no quorum at all. And I'm back in December for the final time, hopefully.
Can we ask for a park to show a parking plan?
There is a parking plan.
Okay.
But I don't remember that you asked for it. But which But Mary, who sat on the September hearing? We ought to. I know the.
So they've already seen it. Yeah. I've sent all the emails to them about what they can see and what they can't. I sent them all the videos.
Right, but shouldn't we at least have the same
people? We do have some of them, yes.
Yeah.
We do have some of them.
Okay.
Some are gone, so.
Okay.
No, but of the ones that are here tonight.
No, I have them.
Okay. So, basically, do you want me to recap, even though we have the full public hearing?
You have to give us a recap. It's been a few months.
Okay, yeah. So, what happens is, Mr. Raffaelli owns the building. He owns many businesses. Raffaelli Construction is his business. It's currently spread out over 4 different sites. He's been renting this building out to somebody else who told him they don't want to renew the lease. So he'd like to consolidate his business, Raffaelli Construction Corp, into this location instead of being spread out in 4 other locations. And we went to the mayor's development team. And as I said, this is in a waterfront one district. And because of that, contractors' yards are not allowed. But if you're familiar with Alley Street, if you start at Blossom Street and work your way down, it's body shops, contractors' yards, body shops, contractors' yards. And that's the character. And when we went in front of the mayor's development team, it was generally acknowledged that this never should have been zoned waterfront. And the city's in the middle of a big zoning review. And I don't want to speak for any city officials because nobody quite said this, but I'm under the very strong impression that when the city is rezoned, this will no longer be waterfront. It'll probably be light industrial where typically contractor's yards are allowed. Anyway, they approved it. And Mr. Cowdell wrote a letter in support. City Councilor Hogan wrote a letter of support. A month later, we went to the City Council and we got a special permit. And now, and by the way, it has more than enough parking spaces. It only needs seven, but there's like 17. But on this, Jerry, can you just hold that up just for a second? Just on this side, this is Blossom Street, this is Dallas Street. On this side here, it's Burnett Plumbing. And there's a fence here. And it's covered, right? You can't see through it. So we just want to park up against the property line instead of the 5 foot buffer. Nobody's getting harmed because there's a fence you can't see through. Can't see through anything but from the street. When the gate's closed, you can't see through on the street. So I'm on the approval to make this a contract with Jeremy and to not have to
comply. Tom, can you talk into the mic?
Yeah, sorry.
Talk into the mic.
Yeah. So is this a lot? Okay, so I want approval for a contract to Jeremy and to not have to be 5 feet away from the property line.
Okay. Do we have any questions from the members or the board? Are there any stipulations?
There was one stipulation about the fence.
What was it? Do you remember?
She wants a new fence. Member Prowitz.
Yeah, what's the matter with the old fence?
What do you think?
I don't know. Looks fine to me, but you know, my standards are apparently not that high.
I like the way it looked and you were
all like rubbed out.
Yeah. It's the current green mesh fence that you can't see through all around the perimeter.
Yeah. Could you just make it a nicer fence? We're trying to upgrade the neighborhood a little bit.
I think this is one of the
nicest
buildings on that street.
I didn't say building. I said fence.
I guess.
Okay. Clean up the fence and make it pretty.
Okay. So I'm also glad with the stipulation to clean up pretty up the fence.
Okay. I don't know how you guys want to word it. I don't
make it as good looking as you can.
That's the word.
Aesthetically pleased.
Would that do, Ms. Krawitz?
That do.
Make the fence as good looking as his lawyer.
Yeah, there you go.
We have a second on this motion.
Who put that one in?
Awesome.
Thank you.
Any seconds on this?
I second.
Right.
Okay. So granted, right? Just a stipulation on aesthetically fix the fence. Okay. So member Peters?
To grant,
okay. Member Krawitz to grant?
To grant, yes, with the stipulation.
With the fence.
Yeah.
Member Olson to grant?
Yes, to grant with stipulation.
Member Maggio to grant?
Yes, to grant.
And Member Lopez Hernandez to grant?
Yes, to grant with stipulation.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Have a good night.
You
got
This fire right up here. Is that summer stuff? Which project are you?
15. Okay. Oh, man.
However you want to do it.
All right. Yeah. So we'll continue now with case number 1008515 Murphy Avenue. We can have the reading on that.
Let me get you the reading. Here you go. 15. I'll see right there. Petition 15 Murphy Avenue, parcel number 036794005, to petition for a finding to permit conversion of a pre-existing non-conforming two-family home into a three-family home, finding that such use is in the R4 apartment house district is not substantially more detrimental than the current use pursuant to MGLC 40A S.6 on a lot with less than the required square footage, parking spaces, and buffer zones. An apartment house requires 15,000 square feet of land. The property has 3779 square feet of land, and stacked parking is depicted. MGL 340S.6 states pre-existing non-conforming structures or uses may be extended or altered, provided that no such extension or alteration shall be permitted unless there is a finding by the permit granting authority that such change, extension, or alteration shall not be substantially more detrimental than the existing non-conforming use to the neighborhood. To vary the provisions of the City of Lynn Zone Ordinance to allow the conversion of a two-family dwelling unit into a three-family dwelling unit in the R4 district. Is that just saying the same thing over again? No. On a lot with less than the required square footage, parking spaces, and buffer zones. Petitioner is further seeking to vary the provisions of sections 9.5.2, 9.5.3, 9.8.1, and 9.8.3, which relate to permitted parking space on site. The variance request requires Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that owing to circumstances relating to the soil conditions, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land or structures but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it is located, a little enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and that desirable relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public good and without nullifying or substantially derogating from the intent or purpose of such ordinance.
Thank you. My name is John Kelty. I'm an attorney. I have offices at 40 Lowell Street in Peabody, Mass. And I appear this evening on behalf of the owner of 15 Murphy Ave in Lynn, Mass. We're seeking two things. We're seeking a variance, a series of variances that would allow for the existing parking on the property. We have provided you with a plan that exhibits three spaces, which in general conform to the requirements of parking with respect to the City of Lynn zoning ordinance. We've asked for variances from each and every section of the parking ordinance, in as much as we originally showed plan with four parking spaces, but they were stacked tandem spaces, one behind the other. Those are not compliant with the current zoning ordinance. It's our position that this property, built in 1820 or thereabouts, and being used as a three-family, built as a three-family, three separate units, and utilized until sometime in the 60s, when the predecessor entitled, who owned it as an income property, they discontinued rentals when the husband of the couple passed away. The widow was no longer interested in managing the property as a rental, completely rental. She then began to rent only two of the units to her family members and personal friends. When my client Ban bought it, he rented two apartments. There was a fire. He acquired the property in 2014 in July. He appeared before the board sometime briefly after he had acquired the property, and was denied a variance, I believe it was. This time around, we're having the advantage of asking for a special permit to allow it to become a three-family, and then the variances that would allow us to use the current configuration that we've demonstrated to the board as parking that would be adequate and varied, although varied from the parking ordinance, parking requirements of the City of Lynn. The property is in an apartment district. It is surrounded by two and three families. My client put together a significant package for your consideration, which includes letters from the Ward 6 councilors, of both the prior ward councilor and the current. It includes letters from our neighbors. With me this evening is my client, as well as our architect. I believe they will have comments to make. We believe that we will not derogate from the intent and purpose of the zoning ordinance. If you grant the special permit, we feel you are fulfilling the requirements for a desirable local need, that it'll be no more burdensome on the neighborhood than the existing structure is today. There is no change to the envelope of the structure. We therefore, since there's no expansion alteration of the structure itself, we believe that the provisions of the current parking ordinance do not apply to us. Notwithstanding that fact, we have asked for variance from those sections. I believe that our architect would like to say a few words about the construction and fill in any blanks with respect to if there has been any addition to the premises. Following a fire last year, the fire department inspected the premises. They found a door in the basement that their report to this board and to my client says that we are compliant. There was a door that was closed in the basement to a gym area. That door ought not have been closed. We removed the door, and that's reflected in the fire inspector's report, in which he said that upon the return to the premises, it was compliant with all fire codes, including the basement was now compliant. The letter gives the impression that it may have been used as an additional apartment. That was not the case. It was the presence of a door. I'm happy to answer questions you may have. I believe that Ben would like to speak next, or is it going to be?
Yeah. My name is Michelle Beheshti. I'm an architect, and I don't want to repeat the same things that was already said. So I looked at the building before the fire and after the fire when I did the drawings to present. There's no change of layout at all. The only changes to the building is the repair of this fire damage. And everything was actually upgraded to fire rating code of the building. Building department and fire department have okayed the building there. So as far as the second and third floor goes, there's no communicating stair between second and third. So in order for a person on the second floor to go up to the third floor or vice versa, they have to go to an exit common stair to get up into it. So every time they have to lock the door, open the door, go up to their own unit. So we are saying that the building was designed as three family originally, and it should, if there's no possibility of making an internal stair just between second and third.
Yes. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. I've been in Lynn since 2014. I lived here. I have two kids. Both of them are working in Lynn. One is working he's a civil engineer. He works at the Lynn, the Mass DOT. And the other one, Aaron, works at the GE Corporation. So we live here, we work here, and I'm a public person. I want to do the right thing. When I retired, when I bought this property, you can see it was disclosed as three family, and it was marked as three family, and it was sold to me as a three family. So because, and then I saw it is a configuration, was a three family, structure. It has both sides, the first floor, the second floor, the third floor. To look at the drawing, they are exactly the equal size, and each one has a two bedroom, bathroom, kitchen, and that is how it was. But unfortunately, they haven't, because she bought it in 1920, in records, somehow nobody from the Lynn has ever visited the place. That's why when I came in first time, I only got the three votes. I didn't get the fourth vote because nobody has seen. So if it had been seen, then it would have been, the answer could have been different. But then I didn't want to go anything to do. I just used myself and I used the other two. I did it in the old house the day I got it. I spent around $25,000. Whether or not, and then I want to make it an affordable place to the community. And my place is the most cleanest place. And at the same time, you could see I charge the lowest rent. So people are saying, why then you're doing it? I said, I need to do a service to the community to the best that I can. I'm not a rich man, but I'm rich in values. So that is whom I am. So I did that thing. And then you could see the person who sold the thing, he wrote a letter to the chairman. And he said that this is the reason that the band got it. And then she clearly said it is a three family, but this is what it is. Because she never used it, because she was a single lady, so she couldn't use the street. So that is what it is. And then after the fire happens, the whole house has been completely brought to the building code, the fire code, as well as the health code. So everything that Mr. Gonzalez, fire chief, he and the building inspector, they're the one who said, Ben, you should go back to the board. And this is a three family. It's walk like a duck, talk like a duck. It is a duck. It is not a chicken. So he said that thing to me. He said, please go back and plead yourself. And then I came to the tax assessor. Then Mr. Gordon came. I said, nobody has come. I'm paying 8,000. He said, man, this is a three family. You're going to pay 12,000. I'm fine with it. I'm fine with it to pay what is legitimately due to be paid. So all I'm asking him, the requesting you is the parking space I had half. So I filled all the way. I have 1,500 square foot. So there are three cars, even by 9 by 18, where the general standards are, you need only 486. So however you park, you have enough space to move around, but the only thing that we are not in a position to give, 5 feet around from the property line, and then 25 feet from the street, I can give. Those are for the new building. This is the pre-existing, non-conforming building, so that the rule should not be applied because it's an existing building. So that's only reason. But the thing, Mr. Poles asked me to go to an architect. I spent $3,000. He made the drawings, and that is what he said. This is the best way we can do it. And then ask the variance. So I'm asked the variance. And then Mr. Peter Capuno came when I came for the first time. And then second time, Mr. Fred Hogan came too. He see that this is what it is. So I'm simply asking you, please give me an opportunity. I'm disabled. I'm retired. This is the income that I live. So I just want to help this one.
Thank you. Any questions, comments from the board?
Can I add one more thing?
Sure.
Band has improved this building beyond the repair of the fire. He has made it really clean, hygienic, and stands like almost like a new building. With all new siding, new roofing, everything done. He's done a great job.
Any questions?
How many parking spots is there going to be available?
They're going to be staffed.
Yeah, so we only park three.
Okay.
So we don't want anything more than three.
Okay.
So three to be at the back and one in the front. So there will not be three parking.
They don't block each other.
So there's still two. Sorry. There's still two per unit. It's just stacked.
No, one per unit.
One per unit.
Yeah, that's what the requirements are.
One and a half.
No, I think it's
how many units?
Three.
But we've asked for variance from the side shape.
Yeah. But there's going to be,
it actually fits. If you've stacked them, you can fit six cars.
It's a one per previous case.
Yeah, that's what the requirement.
Yeah. So I said, I'm going to make comply with that.
So what we have done is we've actually made it three cars. So what we have seen, which I'm assuming you got your plans permitted from the city, right? When you redid your house.
Yeah, so
usually what we see are we see all the exits from each of the
It usually shows something that has shows ceiling, shows all this stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm not seeing that.
If you look at each one is new appraisal was done. So the appraisal is done. It is appraisal as a three family plus total living area. So they have taken the pictures of the going into each apartment as a egress as well as the entrance. Each one has.
It shows two
egress.
Two means of egress.
Two egress.
Yeah, for each one.
And the building doesn't have elevators, so handicap is really kind of
easy. I know, but for Pat, I have to ask for Pat.
I totally understand. For a new building, this is an existing non-conforming.
This is not the... Yeah.
Do we have a copy of that?
Yeah, I sent the folder.
It's all in folder.
We don't consider the 8 feet high and the real estate license can too. 8 feet high and in the buildable area, that's how we consider the buildable area, but we have market as a two, because we can market as a three, so the city safety is a two. So he said, this is here. So he said, market as a two, but it is a three.
Yeah. Yeah.
No change?
No.
No security?
No.
Height, width?
No.
No.
Okay.
No.
Yeah, no. There's pictures.
There's pictures for our process. Yep. There's nothing from the... You want to see this? If there are no other questions from the boards, then we can move to anybody who might be against this petition.
Four.
Or anybody else in favor of the petition. Or no to that end. Okay. Anybody else against the petition that would like to speak? All right. So what is the wish of the board?
I make a motion to approve this building for
Okay, do we have a second on this motion on the table?
A second.
Okay. Yes. Any stipulations?
I personally don't
just making sure
for any of them since that's already been brought up the code after the fire.
I just want to confirm, we've brought up to code as a three family, right?
Yes.
So there's double egresses?
Yeah, all of that. And even the fire department, they asked me to do the hard wiring, but it was not before. I did the whole hard wiring. And even the sheet rocks, they need to have a double sheet rock of the 5A that I did. And I did the all foam insulation, which I never had before. Mm-hmm. So I did that thing. Then also I had the directly connected to the alarm. To the fire department, that's what Mr. Gonzalez said. He said that you know, they've done it beyond what we need. So I just want to do that.
Is your motion inclusive of the variances?
It's for the whole
yeah,
petition.
Yeah,
it's for the petition itself.
Okay.
That's great. All right.
Ready? Okay. A motion to grant for 15 Murphy Ave. Member Christopher?
Yes.
Member Krawitz?
Yes.
Member Lopez Hernandez?
Yes, to grant.
Member Olson?
Yes, to grant.
Member Maggio?
Yes, to grant.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming. Have a good night.
Sorry, can't wait.
It was wonderful for you. And thanks for doing a good job, you guys.
Yeah.
We're here to see you. You volunteered.
Good night.
Okay.
So we'll continue now with 25 Boston Street, if we can have a reading of the case.
Mm-hmm. 25 Boston Street, parcel number 072197026. To vary pursuant to provisions of the City of Lynn Zone Ordinance, permit a convenience retail use in the light industrial zoning district. The variance request requires the Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that owing to circumstances relating to the soil conditions, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land, but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it's located, a little enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and that desire for relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public good or without nullifying or substantially derogating from the intent or purpose of such ordinance. We also have a letter on file from Dr. Peter Meany, the counselor from Ward 1, dear Vice Chairman Lopez Hernandez, my name is Dr. Peter Meany. I am the city counselor for Ward 1. I am writing in support of Sumit Sinai. Did I pronounce it right?
Yes,
Sumit Sinai. He is seeking a variance before the Board of Appeals to open a convenience store at 25 Boston Street. It is encouraging to see business owners like Sumit invest in and contribute to the growth of Lynn. As the owner of an established business, Sumit has already demonstrated his dedication to our community and his commitment to the city's development. I wholeheartedly support his request for a variance to open a convenience store at the above-mentioned location and believe it will be a positive addition to our city. Thank you for your consideration in this matter.
Good evening. My name is Tom DeMarcus. I'm a lawyer with that office at 56 Central Avenue, Lynn, and I represent Mr. Saini, the petitioner. He is seeking to put a convenience store at 25 Boston Street, which is in a light industrial zone. And if you're familiar with 25 Boston Street, right when you're coming down Broadway, you turn into Boston Street. There's a little four-store strip mall on the right, which has an Asian restaurant, a hair salon, a foot massage parlor called Happy Feet, and Arthur's Roast Beef. Mr. Saini owns Arthur's Roast Beef, and the foot massage parlor is vacating that store, and he'd like to put a convenience store where they are right now. In addition to Arthur's Roast Beef, Council Meeting references the investment that my client has made in the city of Lynn. Not only has he owned Arthur's Roast Beef for several years, but he recently, over the summer, bought George's Roast Beef on Broad Street in Lynn. So he owns two businesses. I wish I was doing it 32 years old, what he's been able to accomplish. And he's now wants to put a convenience store next to Arthur's. You know, it's a light industrial district, and because it is, we need a variance. But there's nothing light industrial about that section of Boston Street. If you start at Broadway and go down, you got Cumberland Farms, you got the four stores I just mentioned, you got Andy's Breakfast and Lunch, you've got Bank, Salem Bank, Eastern Five, CVS, every fast food restaurant known to man, you know, Burger King, McDonald's, Wendy's, I don't know what else, Popeyes, Taco Bell. It's all food places. And service lines, dollar store, dollar zone. It's all retail and food places. And he wants to put retail in. So it's completely consistent with the character of the neighborhood. The ward councilor is enthusiastically in favor, and we hope you are too.
Thank you. Is there any questions?
Did you get a variance on the restaurant next door too?
No, it was existing already. It was existing. I bought it like 7 years ago. I've been here 7 years in Lynn. Yeah, that was my first business.
Great.
And it's just a convenience store, it's not a liquor license?
It's a convenience store, but if city allow us to put only beer and wine, not liquor, no hard liquor. If not, I'm okay with that too. Okay. It's actually for my my father retirement plan. So he wants to work, but I cannot put him in a restaurant. So he said, find me something. So we can at least stay there and have a cup of coffee over there.
Okay.
Yeah.
So they're just requesting a change in use, right, consistent with the zoning.
Right. Yes. Right. And even the existing use, the foot massage parlor, would be non-conforming. But that, for about 15 minutes in 2016, that was rezoned as the Boston Street Business District. And then they, I think it was light industrial before, and then they rezoned it to Boston Street Industrial District, then you blinked and it was back to light industrial, and I don't know why, but there's nothing industrial about. That's like saying, it's not industrial. That's like saying this head belongs in the Hair Hall of Fame, you know?
So there's no other questions. Anybody else in favor? Petition
Anybody else against the petition? All right. Motion to grant. Do we have a second on this one?
Second.
All right, we have a second.
Member Payas to grant?
Motion to grant.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll change the recipe.
Member Baggio?
Yes, to grant.
Member Olson?
Yes, to grant.
Member Crowitz?
Yes, to grant.
Member Lopez Hernandez?
Yes, to grant.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
That's going to be, pulled over, that's going to be turned over in 1943.
So we'll move now to case number 10092.
Formerly 5 Neptune Street Court, South Street, to vary the provisions of the City of Lynn's zoning to allow construction of a single-family dwelling on a 3,115 square foot corner lot in the R4 district with on-site parking as required. The lot has 80.13 feet frontage along Neptune Street Court, and all other required dimensional regulations are satisfied as shown on the submitted certified plot plans. Single-family homes require 10,000 square feet of land, 75 feet of frontage, 10-foot front setback, 7.5-foot side setback, and 15-foot rear setback. The variance request requires that the Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that owing to circumstances relating to the photo condition, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land or structures but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it is located. A literal enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and that desirable relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public good and without nullifying or substantially derogating the intended purpose of such ordinance. We have a letter here from the lawyer. Dear Vice Chairman.
Attorney Vitale.
Yes, Attorney Vitale, I'm sorry. Dear Vice Chairman Lopez Hernandez, request is made to continue the above entitled matter scheduled for hearing Tuesday, December 3rd. The petitioner's architect frame will not be ready for the meeting. Kindly reschedule the matter to the next regularly scheduled meeting. Thank you for your consideration. So I make a motion to continue. Case number 10092 to, you want to do it 2 weeks?
January 7th.
January 7th, 2025.
Who seconded?
Right. I'll second that.
Okay. Member Christopher?
Yes.
To continue to January 7, 2025. Member Baggio to continue?
Yes, to continue.
Member Olson to continue?
Yes, to continue.
Member Crowitz to continue?
Yes,
to. Member Lopez Hernandez to continue?
Yes, to continue.
Perfect.
Now continue with case 10091, Wandwich Street.
Case Wandwich Street, parcel number 036765027, to permit pursuant to MGLC 40A.S.6, the conversion of a pre-existing non-conforming single-family dwelling in the business district into a two-family dwelling, finding that such use is not substantially more detrimental than the current use pursuant to MGLC 40A, 6 on A, 3, comma, 1.54 square feet. No, yeah. 154.
Yeah, that's the bigger feet.
Is that what it is? Okay, yeah. There's a space there. Okay, yeah. Could figure out what that was. Just sorry, thank you. Or alter, provide that no such extension or alteration shall be permitted unless There is a finding by the permit granting authority that such change in standard and alteration shall not be substantial or more detrimental than the existing non-conforming use to the neighborhood. To vary pursuant to the conversion of a pre-existing non-conforming single-family dwelling into a two-family dwelling on a 3,154 square foot corner lot in the business district with on-site parking within 5 feet of the property and street line. The variance request requires the Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that only to circumstances relating to the soil condition, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land or structures but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it is located, a liberal enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and the desirable relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public goods, without nullifying or substantial derogating from the circumstances.
I'm Attorney Vitale, and Kelsey is the petitioner. She's the owner of the property. She lives at the property. Backing up, this property was before the Board of Appeals, I think, 2001. It's a corner lot, and that's how a single-family home got there. And at that time, the Board of Appeals, among the variances it granted for the construction of the single-family home, was to allow parking within the 5 foot buffer. Last January or February, there was a fire, and timely, the home was reconstructed. And its current configuration is virtually complete. There's a basement unit, and there's the first and second floors. The intention of the owner is that the first and second floors are a unit that would be rented for short-term rentals, and she resides, so it's owner-occupied, which is one of the conditions to have seasonal rentals, that you have to be an owner on the premises. She's in the basement unit, and the it's been virtually signed off by every department, but in order to get the basement apartment approved, we needed to get variance. We have the floor plan that shows that unit, but it's been laid out, and as I say, it's owner occupied. It has three parking spaces, two of which are on the Summer Street side. One is on the Wood Street side, so it has the three spaces that are requisite for a two-family dwelling. And I think I previously had, and I hope you've seen the plan of the basement, so that and that would comply with not only, and I make this a note because I have a similar one coming, but there is a footnote in the zoning ordinance that deals with so-called basement apartments. But if you read it, it says that no level below the first floor shall be used for human occupancy in an apartment or a tenant. And I would suggest to you that a two-family is not an apartment or a tenant. If you look at the definition in the zoning ordinance, an apartment is defined when it's three or more units. So notwithstanding that, and I have the sheet that all the departments have signed off, but for this approved, it's been completed. At one point, they had stacked parking in heaven. They separated the parking. We sort of thought, this is the plan that the Board of Appeals in 2001 approved for the construction of the house and the parking spaces that they then had. And you've seen what we proposed with respect to the parking. And as I indicated, the plan that you have before you by the criticals, shows the it's an emergency window, which is required when you have sleeping. That's a building code matter, but if you look at the plan, that is reflected. There are two means of egress. The room is seriously virtually completed, and all of the inspections have been signed off. And the one issue that remained was the separation of the units, so that the basement is separate and distinct from the unit that's above. It's the one and second floor, which is going to be for seasonal rentals. So at the suggestion of the people who inspected,
that had a list of all the inspections that they signed off, they said, why don't you go and get the basement legalized? And to do that, that's why I'm in front of you. And the reason Kelsey's now standing up here, she's nervous and said, I hope I don't have to say it.
Questions? Board? Is the utility room in the corner, is that part of the basement unit or all?
Excuse me?
The utility room?
Yeah.
Is that part of the basement unit only or all?
Yeah, no. I believe that the water meter is there, that it's one meter.
Okay.
And that the electric meters are there.
Okay. What about the?
So you only need two meters in it to fill it.
Yeah, where's the heating units? You know what I'm talking?
It's in the basement.
They're in the basement.
Yeah.
So the back utility room?
Yeah.
Are those on the floor themselves or are those raised on the basement?
Raised.
Thirds?
Yeah.
Any other questions? Other questions or comments? Anybody else in favor that would like to speak on the petition? On behalf of the petitioner? Anybody against the petition would like to speak? All right. What is the wish of the board?
Make a motion to pass the petition.
Do what?
Accept the petition.
A motion.
A second.
We have a second.
Any stipulations? Okay. Member Christopher?
Yes.
Member Maggio?
Yes, to accept.
Member Olson?
Yes, to grant.
Member Crowitz?
Yes, to grant.
And Member Lopez Hernandez?
Yes, to grant.
Yeah. Thank you.
Good luck. And we'll go with case 10055.
Which is it? Oh, 7th Street. Sorry. 761-763, the case. Oh, there it is. Okay, 761-763 Summer Street. To petition for finding to permit the operation of a pre-existing non-conforming apartment house with three units by adding the addition unit, claiming that such use in the R4 apartment house district is not substantially more detrimental than the current use pursuant to MGLC 40A F.6 on a lot with 7,200 square feet of land with an existing 8-foot driveway. An apartment house requires 15,000 square feet of land, 50 feet of frontage, and 1.5 parking spaces per unit. MGL 40C40S.6 states pre-existing non-conforming structures or uses may be extended or altered, provided that no such extensions or alterations shall be permitted unless there is not a finding by the permit granting authority that such change or extension or alteration shall not be substantially more detrimental than the existing non-conforming use to the neighborhood.
Again, I'm Johnny Vitale. This is Kevin Lopez. And we've been here a long time, this one. Some members may be new, so forgive me if I'm repeating, but this all began back in the spring, believe it or not, when there was a proposal to add an addition, and I went and spoke with Commissioner Donovan because I had a concern about, it was my view that I really didn't need any approval because it was a permitted use, and I wasn't increasing any nonconformity. That's essentially what I thought. But I had a question because of the front steps, whether the fact that it's pre-existing nonconforming, it comes sort of right to the sidewalk line, whether I would need relief for that. And I had an argument that said I didn't, which was, if you look along, if you read the footnote about the front setback, it says you got to have 10 feet from the sidewalk line, or you got to be in line with the adjoining houses, adjacent houses. If you look up and down the street, we're going to be in line with the... So the front setback really wasn't an issue, so I thought I was home free. Except the commissioner wrote me a letter and said that I needed, and I didn't really dispute, I do philosophically, but that's a different story, that I needed a what's called a 48-6 finding, that what I was proposing was not substantially more detrimental in its effect on the neighborhood than what was there. But my argument was, but I'm in a multifamily district and I'm proposing a multifamily, so how can I be more detrimental? But he wrote a letter that said that I couldn't get a permit unless I did two things. I did two things, and one of them was the 48-6 finding. But then he came in and said the 8-foot wide driveway, if you recall, those of you who were here, that the 8-foot wide driveway was not in conformity. I needed a variance to the 8-foot driveway. Well, that was one that sort of got me, because again, I thought it was then 8 feet forever. So we came before you then seeking the 48-6 finding. Then there was a question of a couple of members with regard to a better plan. And their better plan was, why not put the driveway on the other side? And then if you recall, we had an issue, I thought, with the telephone pole. That was that. But then we actually had a meeting with a member at the site who made suggestions, and some of the suggestions that you made, and Lopez agreed to those suggestions. So the addition's now at the back, and the driveway's now the left side, if you look at it. And the pole's not an issue because we got a permit from the DPW that's right here that says we can do a curb cut and come in on that side. So that then allowed us to not need a variance for the driveway that was the 8-foot driveway, because we're going to make that a lawn. We're going to come in on the other side, and we're going to have a 12-foot wide or more driveway. We have the requisite parking. The addition goes at the back, and this is shown in... These are the large set of plans with the plot plan that shows how it all fits together. So I was tempted, when you only had four members, to proceed, because, as I think I said to some of you, we did what you said. So essentially, I just wanted, because I can't really recall whether all of you were here then when it all began, how it evolved to where we got. But I wanted you to know that not only did we follow your suggestions, but we took it further, because I was a kind of a disbeliever about the telephone pole and about could we get in the driveway. But the DPW has provided a street permit that allows us to come in on that side, avoid the pole, access the parking spaces, and so it does come together. And that's sort of the update with respect to how we got to where we are.
We have any questions from the board? I'm glad to see that it was resolved and the poll was not an issue. Everything could be spaced out. I remember that discussion. Very happy that that could be accommodated and the other driveway is not an issue anymore. I still see the language on the petition still referencing the existing 8 feet driveway, et cetera, as part of the petition itself. If we approve this, does this become an issue, or is this essentially null because of the plans that are being submitted?
Correct. My recollection was this, that said was first before the board, with a brand new petition that starts 48-6 and the variance, all came up with plans that eliminated the need for the variance. So with these new plans, this board could act on that.
Right.
So I'll move to approve.
Second.
Sam, can I have those plans?
Great. Second.
Who was second? I'm sorry.
Member Kraft.
Thank you.
So his approval basically the setback.
Member Payers?
Ms. Grant?
To grant? Member Maggio?
To grant.
Member Olson?
Yes, to grant.
Member Lopez, Mikulkowicz?
Yes, to grant.
And Lopez Hernandez?
Yes, to grant.
Do you want this bigger? You want a bigger one?
No. So the other one left is Breed Street. Is that the other, is that?
Yeah, right. Breed Street, sir.
And I know that you, Lyndon, are you staying on your free will? Okay.
They're enjoying it.
It's nice to know.
They thought they'd visit us.
So final case, I believe. One Breed Street.
One Breed Terrace, Lynn, Massachusetts, 09356804 9. To vary the provisions of the City of Lynn zone ordinance to allow the conversion of pre-existing non-conforming two-family house in the R1 single-family residence district to a three-family home with 2542 square feet of land where 15,000 is required. And 45 feet of frontage where 50 feet is required. With less than the required right side yard setback and on-site parking within the 5-foot buffer area. Three family dwelling into a 4-family dwelling in the R4 apartment house district on a lot less than the required square footage and frontage. An apartment house requires 15,000 square feet of land. Lot has 33.66 square feet of land. And 41.76 of frontage or 50 feet is required. The lot also does not possess required parking spaces or buffer. The variance request requires the Zoning Board of Appeals to specifically find that owing to circumstances relating to the soil conditions, shape, or topography of such land or structures, and especially affecting such land or structures but not affecting generally the zoning district in which it is located, a literal enforcement of the provisions of the ordinance would involve substantial hardship, financial or otherwise, to the petitioner, and that desired relief may be granted without substantial detriment to the public good and without nullifying or substantially derogating from the intent or purpose of such ordinance.
I'm Attorney Vitale. Sir Ruth is with me, and let me just say this. The ad is not correct in when it says a three-family dwelling into a four-family dwelling. I've been sort of preaching to the choir over and over. Somehow that crept in. This is a two-family dwelling, and we want to add a unit. So what we need are certain variances, but we're certainly not going from a three-family, which it's not, to a four-family. So let me back up.
I believe the action of two-family was three-family.
It does. Yeah.
It doesn't say three or four. It says two and three.
No. She just read it. It says
a
three-family falling into a four-family.
That was our agenda. Let me read you from the ad itself. To vary the provision of the city.
Residence to a three-family home.
Yeah, and parking with 5-foot buffer area, three-family dwelling. No, it still says three-family dwelling into a four-family dwelling.
Not the December.
On the action. It says two to three up here.
Yeah, but then.
And down here, it says three to four.
All right. So that's what it's not.
Yeah.
Okay. But somehow that crept in. Backing up. This building was built in 1820. It's been used as a two-family or more. So Ruth lives diagonally across the street on the property that's owned by the same folks that own number one. I brought with me the city, I guess it's the census, from 2019. That I sort of highlighted, it did in all of one Breed. because what it showed is two things. Is that the petitioners live at number four across from number one, but it also shows eight people living in number one. And that's because number one, the configuration was the second floor and the finished attic, and the first floor in the basement, from what I can determine. But also what I can determine, and based on what they know, because they've been in the neighborhood, they live across the street, is the, was used by many people. If you look at this list, you'll see Sir Ruth's name, and you'll see all these other folks living at that time. So in 2020, the property got purchased by the petitioners. And the layout is as I described. And as you know, the city is now engaged in a survey of properties that are rental properties, whether they're owner-occupied or they're rental units. And there's some familiarity with what's required by one of the owners. And what we found is that the basement was being used, but in my judgment, it wasn't being used to accord with what at least the state building code would require, and clearly not what's allowed in that district. So what is before you is a twofold variance request. One is for the use, which already is pre-existing non-conforming because it's an existing two in a single-family district, but we want to make the basement of the unit that would make it three, and so that's a use variance. And then the second request is with respect to the dimensions, and then as it was read, there are only three on-site parking spaces. If you looked at the photograph that we provided, there are two within in the proximity to the front door facing each other, and there's one in the drive on the left, which is, I think, shown in this photograph, which we submitted. So there's one this way, one that way, and one over here. So those are the variances, because the lot is pre-existing non-conforming. The home has been there since 1820, and when zoning came in, it didn't meet the minimum 1925, which is like 4,000 square feet per single fence. So it's continued that way, it's been used that way, and then we think it was used with respect to the basement in not the way that we conform to what we think both the building code and the zoning code would require. And that's why we seek the relief. I provided a plan from the architect that shows the layout, and again, we've got the emergency egress window. We've got the two means of egress. We have the utility room. This is a studio. I think it's like 500 square feet, 570 is the gross area. And the finished living area is only 384 square feet. So it's a studio as shown on the architect's plan. And so the relief, as I say, we seek is that have recognition of the third unit, have a recognition of the fact that we've got three spaces, and once you have three units, you're in an apartment house. And there's another note that says in the footnotes that if you have an apartment house, and I don't think this was intended for two or three families, it was intended for large structures, if you're not supposed to park, think about this. If you apply this to every three family in the city of Lynn, within 25 feet of the front door. Clearly, the intention of that footnote was to get a four-story building with many apartments, that the parking would either be inside or at the rear, but not within 25 feet of the front door. If you applied that to three families, people would be parking in the street because they couldn't possibly meet the 25 feet. So the relief we need is for the number. We only have three spaces, one for each unit. We need relief for the that buffer issue. And we need recognition of the unit with the proviso that we do all of the things that would be required anyway by the building department to make it a walkable use. As I say, across the street, sort of kitty corner, if you've been to the street, number four, as owned by the same individuals who before you tonight in respect of this.
So I'm sorry, why is she here?
Excuse me?
Why is this woman here? I'm sorry.
She's an owner.
Oh, she's an owner.
And a petitioner.
Okay, I didn't hear you say, I thought you said she lived across the street.
No, well, she does.
But she owns the...
Right.
Gotcha. Okay, I didn't understand.
Yeah. Gotcha. And they were there, and as I showed you, when the census or whatever that is, the city listing in 2019.
Okay. I just have a question on... So I see you've put in an emergency egress window.
Yeah.
The existing egress stairs to the main hall front entry stairs above, is that a whole separate entry for the basement unit?
The one goes out to where the front door is, and that's why you put the note in about the stairwell. Yeah.
I didn't think that was permitted. I thought when, because of, then their egress allows it.
No, that's why he put the note in about the stairwell. So there are going to be two means of egress. One is what we call the doghouse, which is like a bulkhead. And then the other is out the front door, but there's a common hall as you come in the front door because it was okay. A two-family.
That's what I mean. It's a common hall. It's not going into the second phase.
No. But I'm saying the common hall was there because it was always a two-family. Okay.
That's all I wanted to check.
What's in the utility? Utility room? What's in the utility room? It's a pretty big room.
So the water meter, I think there are two electric meters. I don't know that there's a house meter, but there will happen to be a house meter. And it's hardwired, so the fire system.
So with the owner, who's, it's not an owner-occupied, how would they need to get access to that? Or would the apartment need to get access?
You need to go in the front door and then go downstairs to the basement unit. But the unit from the utility room is, I think, is shown in the act of that's Lynn second. And the utility room, I think it's going to have is an extra meter at the house unit for it.
So the apartment doesn't have access to that? I'm just curious how the... I'm confused how to get access to that.
There's a stairwell right here.
So it goes into the utility room?
It goes downstairs and you can go into the utility room.
Yeah.
And then there's a doorway that if you go, you could access from the utility room, you get out.
Okay, so the access to the studio apartment can come down through the utility room?
But if you want to just access the utility room, you just come in the front door down the steps to the utility room.
Okay, and then there's another door into the...
Then, yeah, that's so you can't get locked in.
Okay. Thank you.
And the plan for this is to do rental units?
They are. That's how this sort of all began.
Okay. Because
unless you have owner occupied, the city's got like a 5-year program that they inspect all rental units. So these would be rentals.
So is there already three units on the property, or is there already three units on it? Are there three separate families living in the dwelling right now?
No.
Okay, so you're asking for a third.
Right. Well. The second floor in the finished attic, and then there was the first floor and the basement. But the basement had essentially just sleeping quarters. There's three bathrooms. If you look at there's been three bathrooms there for years, one on every floor, which sort of lends yourself to somebody was using it at least for sleeping.
Yeah.
But to do it lawfully, you need to have the window, and you need to make certain there's two means of egress. And the difference with the studio is that it's sort of one big room with a bed and a bathroom, and it's a very small unit. So it creates another rental unit. Yeah.
Okay.
I have a question for attorney Alana in terms of the language on the advert itself. If we vote or determine on it?
I'm not sure. It does say 2 to 3 family in the first and the beginning. So
As long as our motion is appropriate.
I just think it sort of slipped in, you know?
So is the language on the agenda correct?
No, it also has that. Yeah, that is correct.
I think it was just,
And I'll tell you why. I think if you go back a couple of meetings, I think the very next, I can't recall what it was, but the very next petition had that language, a 3-4.
I remember having to look into it, but I didn't look into it. Somebody else looked into it. So I didn't even think about it.
So is there anybody else in favor of the petition? Anybody else against? None. So what's your board?
Should we grant the version of two-family to three-family?
Two-family to three-family. Is there a second?
A second.
I have a second from Member Perez.
Member Perez, to grant?
Motion to grant.
Member Maggio?
Yes, to grant.
Member Olson?
Yes, to grant.
Member Crowitz?
Yes, to grant.
And Lopez Hernandez?
Yes, to grant.
So I don't know why, but maybe it's the sign of the times, but I want to be, since no one else with you, happy holidays.
Happy holidays.
I commend you for your fortitude. My grandkids bought me a hat that said the Grinch, so.
That's hilarious.
I didn't bring home any.
At least you're smiling, Mr. McMahon.
All right.
Do we have any other business tonight, Mary?
No.
All right, no other business, and these are all, so we're good to resume our meetings on January.
January 7th.
All right. All right, well, with that, do we have a motion to adjourn from anybody?
Okay.
All right.
Okay, great.
We are adjourned. So.